Welcome to Markham Baptist Church here on this last Sunday in the month of November. Just around the corner is the 1st of December, and we'll be lighting the first candle on our Advent wreath today, later on. Advent is that season of anticipation as we look forward with hope to the promises of Christ's coming, the babe in Bethlehem at Christmas, and the experience of Jesus Christ in our lives today. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. And then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together." Let's worship God.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold my hope.
Today's scripture reading comes from Psalm 34, 11 to 18. Come, my children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking lies. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hope to me is when I ask God for something and I put my complete hope and faith in him. I hope with everything in me that he's going to be able to answer my prayers. And honestly, as a Christian, it's just putting your complete faith in God and knowing and hoping that he's going to be able to do everything that you ask and just be there for you when you need it. It's hoping that he's going to be there for you when you need him. And that's just what it means to me.
Encendemos esta vela como símbolo de la esperanza que nos brinda la venida del Señor.
Gracias doy a Dios siempre por vosotros, por la gracia de Dios que os fue dada en Cristo Jesús, porque en todas las cosas fuiste enriquecidos en Él y en toda la palabra y toda ciencia, así como el testimonio acerca de Dios ha sido confirmado a vosotros. De tal manera que nada os falte en ningún don, esperando la manifestación de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, el cual también nos confirma hasta el fin que paraséis irreprensibles en el día del fin de nuestro Señor Jesucristo. Fiel es Dios, por el cual fuiste llamado a la comunidad con su Hijo Jesucristo nuestro Señor.
Para nosotros, la esperanza es un regalo que nos ha sido dado a través del Espíritu de Dios, que nos ayuda con paciencia a resistir las dificultades, que nos revela su amor, expresándolo en la comunidad cristiana.
Vamos a hacer una oración. Señor, hoy queremos darte gracias por la esperanza que nos has dado en Cristo. Queremos agradecerte por tu amor inagotable y tu increíble misericordia. Te amamos y te bendecimos, Señor.
Amén. Amén.
Today's reading is from Mark 13, 24 to 37. But in those days, after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds, with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that the summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey, when he leaves his home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, at cockcrow or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today marks the beginning of something new for the church. Just as January 1 marks the start of a new year for the Western world, Advent begins a new way of counting time as followers of Jesus. New Year's Eve causes people to look back over the old year as they stand on the threshold of a brand new one. they sense the opportunity for a fresh start. On New Year's, many treat time differently. But Advent doesn't simply ask us to treat time differently. It invites us to live into time differently. Not highlighting the countdown of the final minutes of December 31st, but rather to view all of time as a gift to be lived into for God's sake. Time is fascinating. It can be measured with great precision, separating out a winner of a race from the very next person to cross the finish line by milliseconds. And yet in other ways, time eludes us. Sometimes it can go by incredibly fast when you want it to take its time. And on other occasions, it can move painfully slow, especially when you're desperate for it to move forward. It can also virtually stand still for us, as if waiting, holding its breath, waiting for something from us or in us to be realized. We're all counting the weeks, the months, until a vaccine is available for all of us who live lives locked in fear by this pandemic. Coronavirus has reminded us all that time has more than simply one dimension. All in good time, we say. Time will tell, we suggest. Time is of the essence, we lecture. But each of these phrases we use as if able to regulate time to our benefit, which we eventually realize is unrealistic. And then again, there is one who does not only use the time of our lives, but creates moments within time for us to recognize the blessings it contains. Ecclesiastes 3:11 in the Old Testament offers this telling insight. God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He has planted eternity in the human heart, but even so, people can't see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. This world and the times that we're living in are the creation of a God of love. God has made everything we receive from God for a beautiful purpose, to be discovered, to be taken in. He has planted eternity in our hearts. But as Scripture says, we cannot see the whole scope of God's work. It was King David who writes in Psalm 31:15, "My times are in your hands." Do you look at time as merely running out? Or are you on a constant quest to recognize the best ways, even the blessing way, of living in the time that's given to you? The other day I was talking with someone who's juggling a number of significant responsibilities in life. The individual was older than they were young, and yet the focus they had was not on time running out for them, but rather the use of it. The significant difference that they can make by choosing to notice each day given to them, to take notice of it. Mark 13 has been called a little apocalypse because of its focus on preparations for the coming change in time, not just from daylight savings to regular time as we did in the beginning of November, but the change from counting in our time to counting in God's time. Mark shares with us some incredible images, apocalyptic images, in fact. He says, "The sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds, with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven." When we begin counting in God's time, not chronos time, but kairos time, the perspective we once held tightly to is shaken loose from our grip. It's then that we realize that we are held tightly by God. We're held in God's time. Verse 29 warns, "When you see these things taking place, you'll know that he is near. At the very gates," it says. This first Sunday of Advent introduces us to how the church is called to prepare not just for the end of our lives or the end of time itself, as some do, but rather to expect the revelation of God in these times. Listen to the way the Living Bible translation words verse 31. It says, "Heaven and earth shall disappear, but my word stands sure forever." God's words. God's words. Jesus' words in Mark 13 invite us to change our perspective. It points out what in life remains. Not just consistent, but constant. Amid all the things that wear out or disappear, there's one thing that we can depend on that never changes. God's word stands sure. God's presence is real, and Christ is closer to us than we sometimes realize. Mark writes to wake us up, to wake us up to the constancy of God's presence in every day, in the realization that God is ultimately in control, that God's directing time toward all that is good and perfect and true. For those first readers of Mark's gospel, sometime after 70 AD when it was written, the destruction of the temple was a moment in time. It was a moment that forced time, in fact, to stand still for that nation. Suddenly the presence of God who orientated time was in jeopardy. What do you do when that which gives meaning to time, to life, is in peril for you? We like to pretend that we can manage time, that we can plan accordingly. We try impossibly to turn it back, to re-experience time with someone that we love. We try to relive time with someone that we've lost, to recreate a time, a moment in time that we want to remember again, or that we may wish we had handled differently. We wonder if we can alter time in some way or another and change the course of time. Advent is not just about anticipation or getting ready or being ready. Because can we ever be ready for Christ's coming? Can we ever be ready for God entering into humanity, into our sinfulness and our brokenness and into our pain and loss, into our joy, into our love, into our longings? The answer, of course, is no. And Advent will never be long enough. And that's the point. God arrives regardless of our readiness. God will come no matter what kind of stipulations or conditions we try to place on God, just as He did that very first Christmas. That first Christmas when very few expected Him to show up in a manger in Bethlehem. Listen again to verse 29. When you see these things taking place, in other words, all the things that daily threaten to tip our lives off course and challenge our certitude, when you see these things, you know that He is near, at the very gates. This is one verse I'd encourage us all to write down and keep close to us. When the struggles come, we all want to know if God's near. When a pandemic lingers, when uncertainties and hardships seem never to leave us, we want to know if God is near. And this is a verse that reminds us of one who never leaves us. It reminds us that Christ is always near. In fact, He's at the very gates of your heart. He's at the gates of your greatest need. God entered into our time and forever changed it. God lived time with us as a baby in Bethlehem, forever altering what time really means. And ultimately, God entering into time disrupts the times of our lives. In his commentary, David Loess suggests that Mark's little apocalypse is less about end times than it is about pulling back the curtain of false hopes and realities in order to reveal God's commitment to enter into and to redeem our lives and world as they are right now. Right now. Right now, God is near to you and me. Psalm 34, verse 18 assures us that God is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. You and I need to remember that, to remember it when others are facing challenges, so we can be living reminders of God's closeness to those whose spirits may be feeling crushed. But we also greatly need this verse for ourselves when our own lives feel like they're breaking apart. Know that God is near, that God's at the very gates. Rather than direct our attention ahead, whether to the end of time or just to December 25, perhaps this Sunday can offer a present tense Advent for us, an Advent that directs our gaze to this very moment. Imperfect, yet beloved. Fragile, yet important. Flawed, yet beautiful. The very time in which God chooses to meet, love, and redeem us. God's very near, now, right before our eyes. Then you will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Amen. Amen. Would you join me in prayer? Let's pray. On this first Sunday of the season called Advent, O God, awaken us to the hope that we have in Christ, to our anticipation of his coming again, even as he came that very first Christmas, vulnerable and available for all to find and worship. But more than that even, awaken us this day to Christ's presence with us now. Open our eyes and hearts that you are near to us even now in the chaos and in the crises that we find ourselves in, and in the joys that we want and need to share with you, as well as in the jostling around that our lives take amid the unexpected twists and turns which inevitably come to us all, no matter how prepared we think we are, no matter how organized we are for tomorrow. Lord, we're grateful that when life crashes in upon us, suddenly or unexpectedly, although we know not the hour of your coming again, we know that you're near to us in the midst of the mess of this world, just as you were in the world, that manger, that very first Christmas centuries ago. Teach us to count time as you do, O God, that it would not be wasted or wished to pass faster or slower than it is given to us, but teach us to count time in terms of its fullness, its completeness for accomplishing your will and purpose. We pray for all who are struggling today for whatever reason, for those with health concerns due to COVID, for those grieving over the loss of a loved one, for healing that follows surgery or sickness, for worry and anxiety over bill payments or job insecurity or looming retirement, for those struggling with mental health concerns who feel pushed to the brink and need a touch of hope. God, help us to offer through our own life and faith to these people some share of our hope, the hope that's within us found in Christ, not as the formula for fixing all things, but as the gentle shepherd who seeks us and finds the lost, as the great physician who knows us and heals the sick and needy, as our Redeemer who understands us, every need of ours, and knows our sin and yet rescues us, as the Lord of life who provides wisdom through tough decisions and who directs our lives to paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Grant us hope this day, O God, that the steps we take in the days ahead may help us to know Christ and to make him known. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may the God of mercy keep you. May the Holy Spirit inspire your living day to day. And may Christ in glory greet you now and when he comes again. Amen.